Hello and welcome back to our educational video series where we're examining how you can investigate suspicious schedule task activity in Windows Defender for Endpoint. In the last installment of this video series, we walked through the alerts that were generated when we ran an Atomic Red Team test for schedule tasks. In this installment, we're going to discuss the different response actions that you can take on an endpoint in response to those sorts of alerts. Some of the things you can do could include running an antivirus scan or even restricting application execution. Now, neither of those really make a ton of sense in this context. So what we're going to focus on mostly is going into live response. We're going to use the live response console to both list persistence mechanisms, which schedule task could be considered. And then since our Atomic Red Team test dumped a file into the temp directory, we're also going to show you how you can enumerate files from that directory and download them. As a bonus, if you're paying super close attention, you'll notice something unusual in that temporary directory. And that's going to be an installation of notepad.exe. Now, if you watched the previous installment of this video series, where we were walking through how to respond to tests associated with masks, masquerading, you might remember that we took PowerShell, moved it into the temp directory, and renamed it notepad.exe. The fact that notepad.exe is still in the temp directory is a remnant of that test. Anyway, without wasting any more time, let's go ahead and hand it over to Joe Savini, our principal solution specialist for Windows Defender for Endpoint, so that he can explain to us how we can take response actions in response to a variety of alerts relating to suspicious schedule task activity.
We can go ahead and open the device page. And inside of the device page, it actually allows us to take action on the affected machine. Now, in this case, isolating the device may or may not make sense based on a risk management decision after viewing that information that occurred. We really don't have a lot of details about what's in that file that was written, other than that, obviously, we know from looking at the command line options, that's probably just contains the date. But it, let's say it was downloading something, we wouldn't really have any additional context around that. We would have to use some way to investigate that. Restricting app execution might not make sense in this case either. And since it was a behavioral threat, antivirus scan might really be out as well. This investigation package could be interesting because it could contain other forensic artifacts that are related to a greater investigation of what could have occurred on that machine at that time. A full list of those artifacts is available in the Microsoft documentation. I suggest that you do check it out because it does contain a lot of information that you would typically only be able to get with more of a detailed forensic analysis on the machine and parsing of some of those additional artifacts that, sometimes an EDR tool is unable to do because they're computationally kind of expensive things to go through. But there are a few extra things that we can do, including initiating a live response session. So I've actually initiated a live response session on that machine already. So I'm gonna go ahead and type help. Help is cool because it lists out everything that we can do here. Now, when we think task scheduling, the first thing we might think is like persistence, right? So there is an option here, show all known persistence methods on the device. So if we type persistence, it's gonna go ahead and send that through the interactive shell down to the machine and execute on those persistence methods. The cool thing is, it will print these out to the screen where you can then review them. Now, when we think about all persistence methods, what we're really talking about are things like registry keys, run keys. And if we go to the beginning of this command, it actually tells us exactly what information is being presented. So here, in this case, we have auto runs, but if we scroll down a little bit more, it's also going to parse out some service information for us. It's going to parse out some scheduled task information and some other things as well. So here we do see some tasks that are being displayed as well. Now, this is good, but the problem is this was actually deleted, which is fairly common in the case of malware, right? We know that a lot of times things will run and then they will delete themselves. Well, going back to that triage, if we remember, this actually created a pretty unique path. And so if we go to that path, it was in the Windows directory. I believe it might've just been under temp. So while the path isn't unique, the file that it dropped was unique there. So let's go ahead and we're going to change into that directory. And we're probably just going to list the files in that directory to see if that, the file that scheduled task wrote out is in there for us. And if we scroll through, we do see it here. It's called current date. What we can do is we can go ahead and hit git current date. And that's going to actually go ahead and download that file for us. So we see that this is here. Now, just to, I'm not suggesting that you download every piece of malware that you investigate, but I'm just trying to show that there is a flexibility and a power to the capabilities that are provided by Live Response outside of, you know, just the simple what you might see here. Now, a safer option might be something like file info, where we can actually just go ahead and run that and gather some additional information about that particular file without having to pull it down from the machine, right? So this is just going to go ahead and read some metadata about that file, et cetera. So there is some stuff that we can do here to give us some additional information. Like Brian mentioned, there is a notepad.exe in here. And so if we wanted to, we could run file info on that. And that'll give us some additional information on that as well, which if that was part of our investigation at this point, you know, we could find out some additional context around the files that are on this machine. And so this gives us some of those details. Now, another thing we might want to do is consider doing a timeline analysis. So timeline analysis can occur right on the device section. So think about everything in Defender for Endpoint as a contextual view. Right now, because we're in the device context, we can just come up here and we can actually pivot directly to the device timeline just by clicking on timeline. Now, when you click on the timeline, there's a number of different things that you can filter for that can be useful. So it's going to go ahead and just load all of the events that occur on that device. The timeline is cool because unlike the alert story, the timeline really gives you everything that EDR was able to capture and timeline on the device. So when you jump into your filters here, you'll see things like there's file events and network events. So you're starting to get a lot closer to the data and get a lot closer to having more options to see the things that matter to you versus just the things that Microsoft may have highlighted. So we can click this task scheduler activity. And what that'll do is it's going to query the machine and bring us to the particular point in that timeline where we can see the data that's before and the data that's after that task scheduler occurred. So we can actually start to dive in and get some additional context around that. Once we're here, we can see PowerShell created it. And you know, here's the suspicious activity. And when we click on it, it's giving us that information. But you know, we can click on any particular piece of information here and start to actually gather some more additional details here. Now, one of the cool things that Microsoft has built into this timeline view is a dynamic Kusto query generator up here called Hunt for Related Events.
All right, thank you, Joe Savini, for showing us the different response actions that are available in Defender for Endpoint and which ones make sense in the context of a suspicious scheduled task. Also, thank you for showing us that device timeline feature, which lets us get a little bit closer to the data. In the next installment of this video series, we are going to get as close to the data as possible. And as Joe just said, we're gonna go ahead and we are going to generate a dynamic Kusto query. Kusto, again, is the query language that you can use to search for raw telemetry in Defender for Endpoint. From there, we're also going to generate some custom Kusto queries and more generally just sort of root around in the Defender for Endpoint Advanced Hunting Console to find activity related to the test we ran.